see everyone here this morning. Why don't you stand and worship with us?
Morning.
Morning.
Hi, guys. Good to see you this morning. A little light on this side. The right side's going to have to step up their game and get their people out here, right? Good morning. I'm Pastor Mickey. And have you had a good week in the Lord this morning? Have you felt that reckless love of God? I know I have. Amen. Monday, we had Dots Memorial Service here. What a wonderful time. I think there's like 40 people that showed up. And they all had just such wonderful memories and things I didn't know about Dorothy, that I've gained some knowledge. And she was an amazing woman, and she is at home with her Jesus this morning. And I just got a little brief testimony about that. There was a picture board up here, and at the bottom of the picture board was her baptism picture. So the daughter that, or the niece that come in was putting up the board. I said, look at that, you've included her baptism picture on the board. And she turns around, she said, this was the most exciting and important day of her life. And at, 85 years old, I think she had gotten baptized. So I went back and I just looked through 2014, when she got baptized, and what I preached on. I had preached on baptism. And I can remember one Sunday specifically, she came up to me and she said, Pastor, I have to be baptized. And I just think that's a wonderful testimony. And then midweek, Wednesday night, we had 37 kids here on
Tuesday.
Amen. Right? 37. I gotta tell you, it was a little chaotic. You did well, Doreen. You guys handled that very well. But those kids were wound up and bound up and full of energy, but 37 young kids stood in this congregation seating, standing here singing to Jesus. And then on Friday, I get a text from a young man, and Jimmy, stand up. This young man is headed to Westminster Seminary. I can't wait to see what God's going to do with you.
Amen.
I know it's exactly where you're supposed to be. I filled out his application. I didn't realize it would be this quick, but wow, what a great testimony that is. And then on Friday night, to cap that off, I had the pleasure, the honor, the privilege of joining Skip and Krista in holy matrimony. Now, this was beyond all miracles. I'm telling you, not straight, it's the absolute fact, because Skip always said, I will never get married. And he was absolutely serious. He just had it in his mind that he was not to be married until God.
Mm-hmm.
Thursday night, I did his wedding rehearsal, and he got me alone right after that, and he said, Mick, this is proof there's a God. Because I said never, and he saw it fit to be the other way. He is a changed man so many ways around. Keep Krista and Skip in your prayers. They are on a cruise out of Texas, and they're headed down to the Caribbean. So they're off on their honeymoon, and when Skip gets back into the fellowship, probably in a couple weeks, I'll extend your hand of gratitude and fellowship to him. So God is good, amen?
Amen.
And we have a lot to be thankful for, have a lot to pray for. And as we go to prayer, I just want to, Brenda, you've been on my heart all week long. And I would just ask if you would like to come up here this morning so I could pray over you and anoint you, if that'd be okay.
Yes.
And as she makes her way up, church, as an extension of such a small part of God's global church, I would just ask that you would come forward if you will. If God leads you forward, I'm going to anoint Brenda. I'm going to lay my hands on her. And as a church, I would just like to extend that touch.
Lost her, Father, that she's never lost. have the blessed assurance that she lives in God. So Lord, I just ask that you would just bless her tongue, that you would heal her. And even in this last hour, that you would confound all humankind and do the miraculous. But if not, thy will be done as the prayer of a faithful servant. So Lord, as we pray this prayer out, as she opens her eyes, may she not only feel your presence, may she see it. See it, all of us standing around her. She has a big congregation that's behind her, that we will walk this valley with her. And Father God, that we will support her, not just spiritually, but also in her physical needs. We do promise that right now, our vow to her. Lord, thank you. We love you. We don't deserve it. But we do ask on behalf of the power of our great Savior's name, Jesus Christ, and all God's children said.
Amen.
So during that week, I had lunch with my good friend Scott, and he did a men's breakfast yesterday morning, brought a powerful message. In fact, a couple of people come up and said, what are you speaking about tomorrow? It came to me during lunch that Scott will be leaving for missions come April, and I thought, when can you come and just speak about what you are about to go through, what you've been through, and we tried to work out a date, and we came up with today. Today was about the only good Sunday that we could come up with, so I got the board approval, and Scott is here. It was about 15 years ago, maybe a little bit over 15, that my wife and I made a left turn out of our street and ended up at a little church called Calvary Bible Baptist Church. And on that first Sunday that we were there, we were welcomed. It was a small congregation. They were very loving. And right after church, the pastor had invited us over for the next night, on a Monday night, I believe, to dinner. And at that dinner table of that night, there was, I believe, Vicky and Mike, and then there was Tor Fosnes. I think most of you guys know Tor. My wife and I, and then there was this young Japanese fellow by the name of Scott Furushima. And on that night, they asked Jane and I if we would help him in leading and directing the youth ministry there at Calvary Bible Baptist. So as we got to know Scott, the youth gave him this name called the Asian Persuasion. He was a very persuasive man. But if I could give one verse this morning as I introduce Scott, what you have learned, received, heard, and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. What I've learned, what I've seen, what I've understood from Scott as he taught faithfully the word of God over the years is just a humbled love for his Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And I know you guys heard my testimony of how it is I became to love to pray. It's through this man. He probably doesn't know it, but he's the one that suggested that we pray for the church. And we would hold these little prayer meetings up in the upper room late at night some nights, and Scott would just encourage us just to cry out to God, to ask God, to let God be God and move upon our behalf. So that's where I truly learned to develop a love for prayer is through this man. This man taught me a lot. He taught me what it is to be a man of God, and I am so indebted to his ministry, and I'm really looking forward to what God is going to do through you in the years to come. Here is Scott Furushima.
Thank you, brother. All right, sounds like I'm on. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Wow, thank you so much, Mickey. I could spend this whole entire time, just talking about these two people who are leading you, that God has ordained to be your pastor. You know, I love them so much. You know, over the last 15 years, when I think of like the power of God and the transformative power of his word and the Holy Spirit, I think of these two people. You know, when I come here, and every time I come here and I see the church growing and I see just, unity and love and these things happening here, I'm like, wow, God, like, you're amazing, you know? And I just thank you for being obedient servants and for your friendship over the years. And yeah, you guys mean so much to me. But don't be distracted by Iron Man. I am Tony Stark, here to talk to you today. I am a youth pastor at heart, so I'm a jokester. But before we get started, if you wouldn't mind, I'd love to pray with you. By the way, that was amazing worship, worship team. That was right on. Wow, I felt the Spirit of God here. Father God, we thank you so much for this day. We just thank you so much for the gift of life. We thank you for the opportunity and the freedom to come here today to gather like this and to worship you. Lord, there's so many countries out there in the world that we don't know about where they can't do this. They cannot gather freely without fear of police or somebody coming through that door and inflicting bodily harm on them. And so we thank you, Father, for them, but we don't want to forget or neglect the fact that that's happening. So we lift our brothers and sisters up to you around the world who are enduring this, especially in places like China and North Korea, Pakistan, Middle East, many Muslim countries, Indonesia. And we just thank you, Father, for what you're doing there. But right now, I just pray, Holy Spirit, that you would come and have your way. Lord, that you would be here, that you would take away distractions, and Lord God, that you would stir hearts. I believe in my heart that you have been stirring hearts, Father, that you have been stirring hearts to hear your word, stirring hearts to hear direction and purpose, stirring hearts, Father, to love. And so right now, I just pray that you would position our hearts, my heart, Lord, to receive what you have for us today. Yeah, Lord, I pray like just our hearts would just be open and humble before you, Lord God, and that I know I could be long-winded. I know I've got 3 years I want to jam into 40 minutes, but Lord, I just pray that you would direct this talk and that you would speak the words that you want to speak and that you would hit the hearts that you're shooting for. Lord, we give you control. We give you all the honor and praise. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. I got to be honest. Most places that I get to speak at behind a pulpit have dirt floors. and they're outside and have like a lean-to, you know, and it's very hot. And we don't have sophisticated things like this to use. So I'm not used to this. So, but anyway, my name is Scott Furushima. I'm with an organization called Activate International. That's our missions organization. And like Mickey said, I started in youth ministry about in 2003. And after 12 years of youth ministry, the Lord called me to be a missionary. You know, he put that flame in my heart probably mid-2000s when I met these guys. We went to probably a Mercy Me concert, a Casting Crowns concert, and I picked up a book called Revolution and Missions by K.P. O'Hannon. And like it just planted a seed that God kept flaming throughout the years that finally came to fruition that I said, I want to be overseas with the gospel, you know? And so about 4.5 years ago, I reconnected with a friend that I met in 2003. And which button do I push? Is that green button? The arrow. Boom. Boom. I'm telling you, I don't know this stuff. Oh, here we go. All right. So the guy on the left is my friend Jerry. I reconnected with this guy in 2003 and 2015 and 2016, beginning February 2016. And he said, hey, I'm going to Asia at the end of the year for about 2.5 months, and I think you need to go with me. And I had stepped down from youth ministry. I was working in construction. I was hearing crickets from the Lord, you know. I didn't know where I was supposed to go. And that just really resonated with me. God just, you know, hit me in the heart with that. And so for the last 3 years, Jerry and I, 3.5 years, we've been traveling throughout Asia, South America, and Europe doing missions. And this is some of our team up there on the top right-hand side. Right now, we have our Activate team gathered at Jerry's house. I've been staying there for the last week and a half. And Roz to the left, she's from London. We got two from San Diego. Paul from New Jersey, and we had a couple guests that joined us, Carlton and Shannon Deal, who founded an organization called Serve the City. They're based out of Brussels, but they started Serve the City 15 years ago. I'll touch on that a little bit. But they joined us, and right now we're together for about 3 weeks to do a lot of writing for all the material that we need for our missions. Like, it's kind of like ground level, and for the first 3 years we've been figuring it out, and now the Lord's like, okay, now it's time to get organized, and because like so many doors are opening. Michelle down on the bottom right, she's in Brussels. We have a couple more scattered throughout, one's in Virginia and a couple more in New Jersey, but that's our Activate team. And so I just want to share with you a little bit about who Activate is, real quick. I'm gonna try to run through this because I got some good stuff, and I know I can get like sidetracked, like, you know, squirrel, and just like, next thing you know, I won't even get done these couple slides. I'll be like, 40 minutes is done already? All right, our vision, to see the global body of Christ unified and activated to lead transformation in their cities. Unified and activated. You wouldn't believe how many churches around the world need to be unified and activated. You know, we've been finding, as we've been traveling and talking to pastors and connecting with pastors, there are many pastors that as we talk to them, you know, and as we share our vision, they're like, yes, how do I get my church unified and activated? Our mission, to train Christian communities around the world to activate deeper relationships with God, His family, and their cities, then to connect like-hearted communities and leaders with each other to inspire kingdom growth around the world. Deeper relationships with God. Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. His family, love people, and their cities. I believe, I truly believe that God wants you to be on mission in your communities, in your cities. He wants you to bring transformation to Malaga. He wants you to bring transformation to Cumberland County. Bring transformation to South Jersey. To bring transformation to this world. And it starts right here. And our passion is, imagine this. What if every church around the world was actively growing deeper relationship with God, His family, and their local communities? Not just in belief or creed, but in everyday life. We would see the global church transform from an attendance-based gathering to a dynamic family of disciples on God's mission. Does anybody here think that's God's heart and God's will, you know, to be leading transformation in this world? And then, let's see. All right, so, good, I don't want to get stuck on that. So, our missions over the last 3 years has had many faces. You know, before I got started, I had zero training in missions. You know, I didn't know how to pack. I didn't know what was going to happen. You know, when I got on the plane to take off, I didn't know what to expect. I didn't know what we were going to do. I had no idea. All I know is that I love Jesus, and I wanted the world to know who He was. So I'm going to get on this plane with my little backpack, and I'm going to go where he leads me to go, and I'm going to tell people about Jesus, you know? And so sometimes that led to going to a tribe in the Philippines where, you know, nobody speaks English. Thankfully, there's people called translators. But this was my first speaking experience in missions. It was literally to a tribe where they hardly had electricity in the Philippines. You know, it blew me away. I'm like, I'm going to a tribe? You know, like literally they don't have a refrigerator. They don't have a stove. They have to cook over like charred coconut shells to cook their meals every night. They don't have a refrigerator, so they have to catch a fish every day if they want to eat. You know, like I didn't know this really existed over there, and this was the first experience. Sometimes get to talk to big crowds of youth. I love youth, you know. So we were in Indonesia last year, and I got a chance to go to a place called Soe City. I don't have any time to really break this down, but if you're a note taker, Write down this book. It's called Like a Mighty Wind by Mel Tari. He'll tell you about how the revival started in Indonesia in this church right here. And got a chance to speak to these youth. And then sometimes, like this is one of our teams in Indonesia. Bunch of young people, bunch of young adults who just want to serve the Lord. Now, most of these young adults are from different churches. They go to their churches, and they're like, we want to serve the Lord. Like, we want to go and help the poor. We want to go help the homeless. We want to go work in the slums. And you know what their churches say? No, you can't do it. It's too dangerous. Yep, that's not ministry. Ministry is like what you do inside the church. So these young people gather, and they're like, you know what? We're going to do it anyway. We're not going to tell our church, but we're going to do it anyway. We're going to gather just as a group of friends just to encourage each other, you know, as we just go serve, you know, because they're like, we think this is what it says in the Bible, so we got to do it, you know. So the guy right next to me, great guy, great leader. He's a lawyer out there. But they're starting Serve the City. If I have time to touch on that, I will. But they're starting Serve the City. It's one of the organizations that we represent to start citywide movements of volunteering to reach the most forgotten and marginalized people in a city. And then the next one. And then sometimes we work with organizations. God has just been crazily opening doors to work in nations. So after 2 years of sowing into this relationship that God just supernaturally put into our laps, like we're actually partnering with the guy in the background right there. This guy is responsible for starting over 50 movements in all of Indonesia. And this year we finally got to sit down with him and explain everything that we do. And he said, right now, I'm really concerned about the 12 Christian pockets in Indonesia. Indonesia, 250 million people, fourth most populated country in the world, 90% Muslim. Christian pockets, very small, dwindling. And he said, we are very concerned with the 12 major Christian pockets in Indonesia. We want you to come help us to alleviate poverty in these areas to strengthen these pockets. And he's opened up all of Indonesia to work with them, to partner with them over the next 5 to 10 years. And so, like, sometimes it looks like that, and sometimes it looks like, you know, just sharing a message on a dirt floor. And whatever God calls us to do, and whatever doors open the Lord opens, we go through. And it's amazing the opportunities that the Lord opens. And the last one I want to show you is just one that I think has been really impactful for us this year. Because it wasn't on our radar, and it kind of just, I think, really identifies and kind of just says, like, this is who we are with Activate. Like, this is our heart, you know. We were invited to go to Korea this year, and so we were invited by a guy who put together a conference to talk about peace, reunification of North Korea and South Korea. Anybody know what's happening in North Korea right now? Anybody kind of know the condition? Wow. Okay. So it's bad, you know? Like, you know, if you're a Christian, you get caught, prison, maybe death, you know? No food, malnutrition, just very hard. It's out of all the persecuted countries in the world for being as a Christian, North Korea is still number one. 18 years going strong, still number one. And so they're having talks about reuniting North Korea and South Korea. And so we were invited to talk about, like, if this happens, how can we help the poor? Because there's a ton of poor people in North Korea. And so as we went, we started to, because I didn't really understand, like, the whole thing that's going on or what's happening in North Korea as far as how the people are treated. And also we found out that there are North Koreans who are defecting to South Korea. They're risking their lives to get to South Korea, you know? They can't go to South Korea because there's, like, mountains and landmines all over the place. They have to go up to China, sometimes through Laos, sometimes through Thailand, catch a plane, get to South Korea, and then, you know, become a citizen and kind of enter in society. But what we're finding out is that they're feeling like outcasts. They're not, they're like the South Koreans aren't accepting them, because they say the average North Korean is about 15 centimeters shorter than the average South Korean because of the malnutrition in their life, in their society. They don't have good schooling, and so they don't have good job training. So when they come to South Korea, they're looked at as inferior, you know? And so what they're finding out is that the North Korean defectors that are coming over, they're being isolated, and they're not being able to enter into society. They're not able to integrate, you know? And so this guy, I found, this is the peace conference in Korea, and then this was at the DMZ, but this guy, his name is, let's see, Kyun Chal Nam. He defected North Korea in 2014. He said that, this is his quote, "I am lonely, and most of the defectors think like this. He feels outcast. He feels like subhuman, you know? And he risked his life to leave, and he's left his family, his son's still in North Korea, and after like 3 years of being in there, in South Korea, he said, I just want to go back to North Korea. As bad as it is in North Korea, this is his attitude because society's not accepting him. So we met a government official in Korea the last time we were there, and we spent some time with him, and he loves Serve the City. He heard about Serve the City 6 years ago, wants to start in South Korea. And we were talking to him, and we're like, what's the church in South Korea doing about this problem? He's like, nah. He says, there's some organizations that will raise up money to get a scholarship for like one of these North Koreans, and they'll send them to school, you know? But for the most part, there's no integration, you know? And we're like, huh, what if a South Korean Christian family from a church invited a North Korean defector into their home to just share a meal? And he said, that would be revolutionary. You know? And he said, can you come up with a proposal? Write that down and send it to me so I could like get this thing going. And we're like, okay, it was just an idea, but yes, we'll put it together. So we put it together. And like in May, in South Korea, it's family month. So they literally want to kick this thing off in May. So they want us to come back and see this thing get off the ground to begin reunification with what they have now. It's kind of like, you know, if you're faithful with little, you know, the Lord will give you more. Like, let's show faithfulness with who is there now. But church, isn't this what we're supposed to be doing? You know, like, isn't this what we're called to do? Yes, absolutely. And so that's a little taste of like you know, just who we are, and so I just want to get through that because I want to get to something I had touched on in the men's group yesterday. And we were talking about the kingdom of God. And I'm going to run through the same questions I posed to the men real quick, just to kind of get them into your mind. But are you guys ready to go? You got your thinking caps on? You're awake? You had your coffee? All right. All right. Very good. The world is in a mess. The world is in a mess, right? Like, nobody could disagree. Actually, raise a hand. Anybody here disagree that the world's in a mess? You cannot turn on the news. You cannot pick up a newspaper. You cannot go on the internet or on Facebook without seeing just how bad it is, right? Like there is this like craziness all over the world. There's like political tensions everywhere in the world. There's wars, there's like just chaos. As I travel, the world, I think some of the big topics I see are human trafficking. Like, I can't imagine how bad human trafficking is all over the world. People exploiting kids and women and men, you know, for money. Poverty, you know, where we go, like, we see poverty, like, I never knew poverty existed. You know, like, you go through America and you see poverty, and, I mean, they live like kings compared to, you know, poverty that's in the world, you know. I mean, there is just such brokenness and chaos in this world, but the world is in a mess. We can agree with that. Now I want you to put your thinking caps on and ask yourself, why? Why is the world in a mess? Why? What time do I have to? What time? Okay. I'm going to speak fast in some places. So, world is in a mess. Why? Okay. I'm going to give you the answer because I got to go. It's because of the self-centeredness of man. Wow. Can I get an amen? The self-centeredness of man. You know, everybody just looking out for themselves. Everybody just wanting to build their own little kingdom. You know, everybody worried about their own, their pride, their thing, you know, their little thing, you know, working every day, you know, just building up stuff just so we could have our own little lives, you know, and then we kind of have blinders on most of the time, you know. But that's the problem. Like, you know, like, it's just amazing. Like, and guess what? This isn't a localized thing. It is a global thing. No matter where I go in the world, this is a problem. We call it our sin nature. Yesterday, I posed this yesterday to the men that, you know, if you think about it, like, most of your fights in your marriage, because of self-centeredness. Somebody's not giving in. You know, it says we want our way, right? Most of the fights that you get into is because somebody has to have their way, right? And so, second question, was this God's original plan for man? You think he just said, you know what, I just want to create Adam and Eve, let them go to town and just like be just reckless and just sinful and self-centered and not caring about anybody but themselves? Like, that was his master plan, right? That's what he wanted to see. You guys got to say no! So, another question. What was God's original plan? What was God's original design for man? The men are like, I want to say this because I heard it yesterday. I want to say it. God's original plan was that there would be one will and one kingdom. God's kingdom. And if you read, and unfortunately it's only a couple chapters in the Bible that happened before it all got messed up. If you read and you look at the life of Adam, you know, and Eve before the fall, like you could see this. Like Adam literally didn't know what to do without instruction from the Lord, right? He's like probably just sitting there twiddling his thumbs, and God's like, okay, time to go to work. Adam, see that garden over there? Go tend it. Oh, great. Where's a rake? You know, how do I tend it? What do I do? You know, there's no weeds. Can you imagine a garden with no weeds? how about, I mean, this one cracks me up when I think about it, you know, because I think about, like, all the names of them. But, you know, so he's got all these critters, you know, running around, flying around, swimming around. And God's like, Adam, go name them, you know. Like, how long would that take? That would take a long time. But everything he did, he got instruction from the Lord because there was one will, because there was only one kingdom. What happened? What happened? They got all messed up, right? Got all messed up, you know. Grandma and Grandpa, Adam and Eve, they had to go eat that fruit, you know. But I want you to think about the sin in this, you know, because we think, okay, they ate the fruit. You know, Eve saw that it was like probably, I used to joke with the youth, like, was that thing like multiple colors, like a rainbow, you know, like glowing? Like, what caused her to eat that thing? Like, it attracted her. You know, she saw that it was good for the eyes, good for the flesh, probably said, ooh, that's probably nutritious, low in calories, you know? Gluten-free. And then they ate it, but what was the sin? Why did she eat it? a lot of people say, and I thought, you know, yeah, disobedience. This disobedience was a sin. But if you really think about it, the kicker was this. Satan said, when you eat this fruit, you're going to know what God knows. And they thought, huh, so that means I don't have to go to God for instruction anymore because I'm going to know what he knows. So I want my own will and I want my own kingdom. So that was the kicker. That's what got us. You know, so now what happens? So we had one kingdom, and that went to three kingdoms: God's kingdom, man's kingdom, Satan's kingdom. And they gave up their authority that the Lord gave them over the earth, you know, to Satan. And then we got all these problems, you know, in that transaction, taking the fruit, eating it. God was no longer their center. That's how self-centeredness began. All right? So now things are broken. What's God's solution? I'll give you couple of seconds to think about this. What's God's solution? And I'm just gonna put my face up there so you don't have to look at our man down there. But what's God's solution to that problem? Jesus. See, Jesus came to restore all kingdoms back to one kingdom. So when you think about how one kingdom became three kingdoms, God said of God's kingdom, now you got God's kingdom, Satan's kingdom, man's kingdom. When you think about man's kingdom or the kingdoms of this world, you've got 7 billion kingdoms running around this world, mostly opposed to God's will and God's kingdom. That's why the world is so messed up. Because everybody's self-centered. We're all trying to live for ourselves, you know? And you've got 7 billion of these people around the world trying to build their own kingdoms. So Jesus has to come to restore everything back to one kingdom. Guys, like, that is good news. That is good news, right? So now, how does that happen, though? And actually, I could put this up here. All right. So how does that happen? How does God bring back everything to one kingdom? How does that work out practically? So God's solution is to restore the world back to one kingdom, his kingdom, his original design, so that we could be one with him again and under his rule. And I'm going to give you two verses as we look at how this happens. So if you have your Bibles, please go to Matthew chapter 18, verses 3 and 4. Yesterday, as I was kind of just going through this, like, this landed on my heart. This morning, in my Oswald Chambers YouVersion app daily reading plan, this was the verse. And then a couple minutes ago, as you know, Pastor Mickey and I were praying, like he literally prayed this verse, and I'm like, "Wow, Lord is highlighting this verse." You know, this is important. All right. So, in the Garden of Eden, Genesis chapter 1 and 2, Adam was at zero. Remember that. Adam was at zero because he didn't have anything. Everything he had came from the Lord. He was at zero. We have our own kingdoms. Everything comes from us. We're not at zero. In Matthew chapter 18, verse 8 and 3, it says, And Jesus said, "Truly I say to you, unless you turn and become like little children..." Wow, what's going on? How come it keeps moving on me? Oh, okay, this is funny. I'm changing it on my computer thinking it's changing it up here. Okay, I'm telling you, that's how much I use this technology. And Jesus said, "Truly I say to you, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." Whoever humbles himself. And so when I see this, and I think this is why the Lord has been highlighting it, it says, unless you turn and become like children, unless you go to zero like Adam, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. That's what being born again means. Going back to zero. So for those who love to share the gospel, for those who like to evangelize, that is a big thing for people to understand. 12 years of youth ministry, I didn't get that one right. I didn't quite understand that. I was always trying to like figure it out. I'm like, wow, this is so complicated. Like, I understand it, but it's so deep, you know, because, you know, it's like when do you really know somebody believes, you know? Somebody, if they want to be born again, they have to go to zero. They have to be like Adam. John chapter 3, verse 3. Jesus is talking to Nicodemus. Jesus answered him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." I believe these are parallel. I believe these mean the same thing. I believe these mean that you have to be like a baby. As a baby born again, you are at zero. As a baby, everything you do comes from mom and dad. You know, you have nothing. Everything is coming from a source. And I just believe that, like, when one is born again, they have to be like Adam and go back to zero. And before I get into a little bit more of the kingdom, recite with me just the beginning of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now, just from the looks of it, you guys know that verse, right? You know that prayer, and you've got it memorized. And some of you have been praying it for years. Maybe longer than I've been around, you know? All 30 years. But how many times do we really stop and think about those words? Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Because this is going into God's solution. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. How does that happen? We pray that, you know, and we go through the motions of praying it. But how does that practically work out in your life? Do we know? I think the answer is we have to go to zero. As Christians, we have to go to zero. Because when you become a Christian, does your self-centeredness die? Do you all of a sudden have no problems with pride and ego? You know, you become a Christian, there's no more fighting in the home. You know, you become a Christian, like, you can't have your feelings hurt. No. Like, you take that stuff with you, right? But I really believe that's why Jesus tells us that you have to die to yourself daily. That's right. Daily. Every single day. You know, Galatians 5, you look at it, it's just like this battle every single morning between your flesh and your spirit. You know, when you wake up, your flesh is raring to go. Like, it just wants to get going, and it wants to disrupt. You know, it wants to conquer. Your flesh, right? And I don't know about you guys, but I've developed a practice of first thing I do before anything is read scripture, pray, you know, because that's so important because I know my flesh and how easily it's riled up and how easily it's agitated and all that stuff and how easily it's fed. I got to feed my spirit, you know, because I know that, like, that battle is ready to go. And you know, you people who are married, you probably don't even get out of bed and, like, your spouse says something and, like, all of a sudden your flesh is, and you're just arguing, you know, your flesh is at it, right? And that's our self-centeredness, people. And we have to battle that thing every day. And guess what? You could be a Christian a long time and still be pretty self-centered. No amens on that one. I'm going to be honest with you. Like, I have been serving the Lord for since 2003, and I'm pretty self-centered. You know, like, I see some stuff that I'm just like, wow, Lord, you know, like, you got to tackle that one because, you know, that one's tough, you know. Yeah. And believe it or not, I think Mickey's probably got some stuff, too. No, you got a perfect pastor. I got to get him in there somehow. All right. Does anybody here take notes? If you do, like, take notes on this one. The way that kingdoms, the 7 billions or the many kingdoms out there, the way they are restored is when we as Christians give up our kingdoms, go back to zero, and begin to receive instruction and direction for life directly from God. That's how we fulfill thy kingdom come, that will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's how God's kingdom comes. That's how his will is done on this earth, is us giving up our self-centeredness and our wills and pursuing the heart of God and seeking what is your will. What do you want me to do on this earth? And the more you can do that, the more useful you become and the more of the kingdom he could bring through you on this earth. I mean, who wants God's kingdom to come through them? Two of you. All right. Again, we're making headway. All right. That's good. I should have taken a picture. So now, what? This is the question. All right. So some of you guys are scared. You're like, ooh. There's people behind me who might hold me accountable. So now, here's a big question. What is the Lord's will? What is the Lord's will for us to bring his kingdom? And I just want you to really think about this. And I wish I had time to unpack this. I'm going to tell you right now, I went through a 4-day seminar, workshop, 10 hours a day. And I just spent 3 weeks with my friend in Kuala Lumpur who taught this. Like, just to sit at his feet, to kind of wrap my head around this, because I think it's that important. It's a message for the world, the body of Christ around the world. Because if we don't get this, like, we miss the mark. And we start fighting about stuff that we don't need to be, because we don't have our focus on what God wants us to be focused on. I used to spend so much time fighting about stuff that I just have to repent of and be like, wow, Lord, where was this in 2003? Because if I had this, I could have put so much more energy into this, you know? Instead about stuff that, honestly, now that I look at it, it's not important to the Lord. This, Luke chapter 4, verse 18 and 19, if you have your Bibles. Luke chapter 4, verses 18 and 19. I'm sorry I didn't put this up on the slide. Oh, wait, I did. Oh, yeah. I'm changing it on here, thinking it's changing on there. All right. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And this is Jesus, you know, entering into ministry. He's reading from Isaiah. And he says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has appointed me to proclaim the good news to the
poor.
To the
poor.
Wow. Okay, so as I was learning about this whole understanding of the kingdom, you know, you just sometimes it's like, and I just started like just scouring scripture. You know, just got into the Gospels, and I was like, let me look at the life of Jesus. You know, I want to get this thing right. Because if there's one person I want to follow, it's Jesus. You know, and I want to challenge you, and I hope the Lord's talking to your hearts right now to challenge you. I want you to scour the Gospels and see what was important to God. Because as I've been traveling the world in the most poor places that you could ever imagine, the Lord said, it's put on my heart. I'm showing you my heart. I'm showing you who I am. I'm letting you walk in the places that my son Jesus would walk. And I'm letting you see them through his eyes. And I want you to go tell the world. I want every Christian that you meet to know that this is my heart. Because once you get this, and you become unified and working together, man, you can make a difference and you could literally bring transformation to this world. You know? I know Mickey and Jane have this heart going to Haiti. You see it too. You know, this is what the church, this is the purpose of the church on this earth, I believe. And so as I think about the years that I used to be concerned over stuff that I look back now and I'm like, yeah, that's probably not as important to the Lord as I thought it was. We visit places like this in Indonesia. And there's almost 10 million people in the capital of Jakarta. And 26% of that population live in places like this. They're called slums. Yeah. Like the top right picture, there's a little canal there. Like that's like sewage and standing water. It's probably some of the most putrid water on the planet, you know. And this is right next to and behind like where they live, and you gotta smell it, you gotta jump over it to get to the thing. And then, you know, bottom right was another slum we went to that's under a bridge, and like just trash everywhere, and people living like this guy over to the left, like literally we're in his house, you know, like this is where he lives, and we're sitting on his bed. And then you reach out and you can almost touch the wall. He's got a water container, a fan, and you know, some stuff, but like nothing to cook with. There's no bathroom. You have to go use a, you know, community space. And I'm gonna tell you, there's some hearts out there that just blow me away as far as just like the level of their love for people. Like, so we're going into the slums. And so I just believe that the Lord, when he was here, he was going to the most forgotten people. He was going to the most marginalized, the most forgotten, the poor, the hurting, the broken, you know? And so the slums is the most marginalized people. But this guy in the top left, he's a transvestite. And there's a guy who does ministry just to the transvestites, the most marginalized of the most marginalized. And he goes to them every week, ministers to them, shares the gospel, holds retreats to come just to love them. And then when they become Christians, he opens up their home to let them stay in there to disciple them. It's the hardest thing ever because they just keep leaving, you know, because they're like, you know, it's so hard for them to convert and live a Christian life, you know. They don't know what to do in life. No, they're an outcast in the society. And I'm telling you right now, when you spend time in these places over and over and over and over and over and over and over, you know, your heart just changes. You know, your heart, all those hard areas of your heart, you know, all the things that you think's important, you know, all the things you complain about, like, it just, like, changes. And God's like, yeah, this is my heart. And then this lady under a bridge, her place is maybe 5 by 10, you know. And I'm just like looking at her. And I'm like, what's the good news of the gospel to her? You know? What's the good news? So I'm not worried about, when you're in a situation like that, all the things that we fight about, all the things that we think are important, like, there is nothing more important than that woman right there and thinking, like, how can this be? How can people live in less than human conditions? I know pets in America that have it so much better than this woman right now. Like, nothing matters because God is showing you what is important to his heart. What's important to him? This is important to him. People like this are important to him. This is where Jesus would be. No doubt. So what's the good news that we could bring somebody like this? You know what the good news is supposed to be? The good news is supposed to be God has sent Jesus into this world so that our lives could be changed, so that our sins could be forgiven, so that his spirit can dwell within us, so that now we have the opportunity to die to ourselves, to let Jesus live through us, and be Lord over everything, over all of our finances, over all of our emotions, over all of our desires. He doesn't want to be Lord over 10%. He wants to be Lord over everything. I was so convicted this year. Like, I went home and I had to move out of my apartment and I just started selling everything. You know, it was hard. I started selling a little bit, you know, because I didn't want to have a lot of storage. But as I did that, it became so freeing for me. And as I just kept selling more stuff, I'm just like, Lord, I want to sell it all and just use everything you give me to go and help these people. You know, because that's his heart. That's his heart. And I know that sounds a little extreme, but I believe that's his heart for his church. You know? And and so I got a couple minutes. All right. Well, I know he's working in hearts right now. And all I want you to do is I just want you to get with the Lord one-on-one sometime today, sometime this week, and just say, was that Asian guy speaking for you? Like, were those your words or were they his words? I want you to get alone with him and just say, Lord, tell me the truth about this. Is this your heart? Is this something I should be concerned about? You know? Honestly, Jim, if I was a youth pastor, man, again, back then, and I knew this, like, all my focus and heart and energies would be to create disciples to make a difference in the world. You know? Everything. How we plan missions trips to get them to these places, because this is transformational stuff. This changes hearts. I mean, this has transformed your heart. You know? And I want you to pray. I want you to just go before the Lord and ask him, what am I supposed to do with this? You know? Is there something I can do? Is there something you want me to do? And so this is missions for me. This is where the Lord has planted me. I've surrendered my life to him for that. And, you know, just continue just to go on this journey and adventure. I'm going to go back to my buddy Jerry's, and we're going to keep, you know, writing stuff, and we're going to keep, you know, just plowing forward to, you know, and I just get ready for, like, the doors that the Lord opens this year. And so I want to invite you to journey with me on this, you know. And I want you to, I have prayer requests. So if you have notes, I'd love to give you some of these prayer requests to pray for me. I've just made the decision to go full time. And so I need lots of prayer for that. I am actually on my journey to raise and support, and then God is blessing. So my monthly number I'm trying to hit is 3,000. I'm at 1,100 now, and God keeps plugging away at that. Two, I have a beautiful girlfriend in Brussels, and I need lots of prayer on that. and so we are actively like seeking the Lord's will. There's a God. And God is good. And so she's a godly woman. We're praying, just, you know, how does this all fit in? You live on the other side of a pond called the Atlantic Ocean. And, I'm in this crazy missions thing. And so, like, how does that work, Lord? And then team definitely needs prayer for, as we are together and trying to put all this material together. Like, this is the first time I've seen some of the team, some of the founders. 3 years I haven't seen some of the team. They came over to San Diego. Like, we are together just hashing it out, just putting stuff together. And we're starting to work as a team, so definitely need prayer for that. And also, as Jerry and I prepare for this year's schedule, I mean, last year I was part-time. I was overseas for 5 months. You know, so I don't even know what a full-time schedule is going to look like for that. So I definitely could use prayer as far as, like, you know, for us, for this year's schedule and how that's going to look. But I love you guys. I love you guys. You know, thank you for your time. You know, it's so special whenever I get a chance to, you know, bring this message to a people. And hope you enjoyed. Hope you were challenged. And all right. Thank you.
Dying to self, dying daily. And Peter just drives home the fact, look, you guys are strangers, you're aliens, and you're sojourners. And if you find yourself comfortable in this world, you won't recognize other strangers, other aliens, and other sojourners. In fact, we'll kick them to the curb. We'll just count them less than we deem ourselves. Because we are self-centered by nature, and dying daily is a hard road to do. I know, you guys know my heart, you know where I'm at, and I just confessed to Scott over a three-hour lunch on Wednesday, man, things are just happening in my life at breakneck speed. I don't know where God's gonna lead me in the next few years, but I'm excited that God is alive, His Spirit is alive within us, and He's just moving us as a church, and next week I have a great sermon prepared along with communion, but this guy for now needs support, and he's about $2,000 short a month. He's at the infant stages of raising support. I couldn't imagine going around other churches, can I graciously say, begging for money to the richest people in the world, right? We are the richest people in the world. You can go anywhere else, and I truly believe that the Americans are pretty well off. So when it comes down to finances, is God in charge of it all? I have to sit in front of my budget every month and weep at some things I've done and rejoice in other things that God has done. So no, He's never truly Lord of it all. But this man has sold everything to go. We know his heart. You've heard it. So us as a board, we're coming together in March. We're going to consider and pray about it. I want you to consider and pray about it and keep Scott in prayer. He's got some prayer cards out there. I love you, buddy. And if I can just pray for us and people dismiss, let's stand. Our Heavenly Father, we're just thankful for the goers in the world. Father, I thank you for Scott, for the heart that you have stirred within him, for your Spirit to send, and for his willingness to go, to be the hands, the feet, and the eyes of Jesus. Now I just ask that as a church, there's goers, and then there's senders, supporters. So, Father, I just pray that we support two missionaries here, and prayerfully you'll bring many more to us. So, Father God, there's a bigger thing that's happening than just here at Malaga. We realize that. But we first thank you for this community, to where we're supposed to be light, for the opportunities within the workplace. We are all on missions, but very few of us are missionaries. Cross the cultural borders, to cross those boundaries, to cross the safety net of the United States and go outside to China, to North and South Korea. So, Father, I thank you for Scott. I thank you for this congregation that you've placed here strategically, specifically at this moment. And, Lord, I know you have just stirred our hearts this morning. So, as the song said when we started out, break our hearts for what breaks yours. May we see the sickness, the poverty, the poorness. May we understand the good news of the gospel, how you bore, you carried our sins on that cross many years ago. And we should be the most joyful, powerful, serving people, not worried about gain in this world, not worried about 401ks, not worried about whether we're going to have enough for ourselves. You have promised to never leave or forsake us. So, Father, I just want to ask that you just continue to move in your people, not just this morning at this hour, but as Scott, challenge us throughout the week to open your gospels, to see the good news, to see how we must come back to zero, to become like children, or we're just not going to see the kingdom of God. So give us eyes to see, ears to hear, and now give us the transformed hearts to go out and make a difference and be light in this world. We ask it all in your holy and precious name. And all God's children said,
Amen.